I'm Sam Torrance, and this is Tempo Public Square.
Hi, I'm Susan Kennedy. Once in the fast lane, the auto industry today is just merely chugging along.
Whether it's new car sales, financing challenges, or service issues, our car dealers are feeling the pinch.
And that affects jobs and payroll taxes, sales, and corporate taxes, too.
The dealers are running on empty, and you'll know why.
Right now on Tempo Public Square.
Support for Tempo Public Square is provided by the members of PBS 39 and by
building a workforce system called PA Career Link Lehigh Valley, training the workforce to meet employer hiring needs, connecting employers with workers, and workers with jobs. Lehigh Valley Workforce Investment Board.
Thanks for joining us. News from Detroit has left many with the feeling that the auto industry is deflating like a punctured tire. So how do those Motor City woes impact us?
It's not just about where the cars are manufactured or where the parts warehouses exist.
Detroit decisions drive your area dealers, the folks who sell and service those cars we've all come to depend on.
Tempo Public Square's Laura McHugh gets up close and personal with the people who keep us on the road.
Newspaper headlines read doom and gloom for the big three, but lower car sales don't just affect the automakers in Detroit. Dealers all across the nation have closed their doors and laid off employees.
You know, I don't know that there's a dealer out there that hasn't been looking at making cuts.
We're all looking over our shoulders, especially the dealerships that went out. I mean, I was friends with the people. We dealt with them a lot. They were in business a long time, a lot of years.
In 2007 and 2008, plummeting new car sales drove 116 Pennsylvania dealerships out of business, including McGarrity Ford in Chestnut Hill.
We had 35 employees at the Ford dealership. Most of them had been there probably for most of the 20 years. That was extremely difficult and emotional, dealing with those people, letting them know that the doors were closing.
We caught up with Joe McGarrity in late January as he prepared for the Philadelphia Auto Show. Joe explained that he cut the Ford dealership in late 2008 to make his larger Chevrolet dealership in Montgomery County stronger.
I didn't want to be out there with two dealerships undercapitalized, basically. I wanted to be proactive instead of have something happen to us.
In Pennsylvania, new car dealer sales total $29.8 billion a year. That makes up almost 18% of the total retail sales in the state.
When you see Chevrolet or Ford or Toyota or wherever, and they see that name on that building, that's not the global corporation that makes these vehicles. That is a local businessman or woman that's an entrepreneur in that community and is part of that community, or they wouldn't be surviving and doing the business that they do.
More than 50,000 Pennsylvanians work at a dealership, making an average of $43,000 a year. The average dealership employs 44 of them and has an annual payroll of $1.86 million. So every time a dealership closes its doors, dozens like David Willard lose their jobs.
Even though you're expecting it, you really don't expect it, you know, and you have an idea and it's lingering in your mind. But when they actually sit you down and say, this is it, I mean, it's rough.
David says he got laid off in October and his former dealership shut down at the end of December.
I guess he was trying to, you know, cut corners and still try to save the organization, but in the long run, it didn't work out.
Just after the new year, David started work in the service department at Lankford Buick Pontiac GMC in Conshohocken.
We're off probably 30% new car sales, but used car sales are good.
Owner Mark Lankford has watched several dealerships close their doors in recent months.
And you just hear about it more and more, and it's going to happen. Everybody has predicted that there's probably going to be another 1,000 dealers close nationally for the year 2009.
General Motors, one of Mark's brands, recently announced plans to cut 400 dealerships a year until 2012. With new car sales slumped about 30%, Mark says he already laid off a few employees and has cut back extras like cleaning and advertising services.
I've seen downturns, and I've seen times when things you would think could not have been worse, but I haven't seen times that are quite like this.
We don't have the floor traffic we had before because people are, honestly, I think they're afraid to spend their money because they don't know how much money they have, and they don't know, you know, if they're going to have it a month or two or three from now.
Like many dealership employees, Lankford's new car sales manager, Jim Polino, and his sales staff rely on commission for most of their income.
Well, we've had a couple of better months, but not good months. There hasn't been really any good months in a while. And I laugh about it because I really can't remember the last good month we had. You know, it's been off.
While many people have a hard time seeing themselves in a brand new car in today's economy, many dealers are reporting used car sales are holding steady and in some cases even increasing a little. Polino reports they used to sell 2 new cars for every used car, but now he says they sell about 1-to-1.
Selling new cars is not a very profitable proposition right now, but you'll find that a lot of the dealerships that are making it maybe better than others are doing a better job in other areas.
Mazzacola says in this economy, dealers with solid financing and an adaptable business plan may actually weather this storm whenever it eventually ends.
I don't know when it's going to break, whether it's 5 years, 2 years, 3 years, 6 years. Whoever tells you is probably lying because they don't know for sure either. But when it does, we'll have one of the most successful dealer bodies we probably have ever had. It's just a matter of who is left when that occurs.
They may not know when this storm will end, but both Joe McGarity and Mark Lankford hope to be there when the sun finally comes out. For Tempo Public Square, I'm Laura McHugh reporting.
Thanks, Laura. You know, that reminds me that although there's a lot of focus on the big three manufacturers right. And the problems with that, it's the foreign brands that are also being impacted and also affecting dealers as well. So. And our customers, our viewers. So
it's true. Well, Toyota, the big daddy, has shut down production, like many of them, on any cars because they need to move what's on the lot out of here. And to help put a better local perspective on all of this, we have a gentleman here today from the Greater Lehigh Valley Automobile Dealer Association, Tom Kwiatek, the executive director. Thanks so much for being here today.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So, Laura had mentioned in her piece, whittling down the number of dealerships, and I know that a lot of the auto manufacturers want to do that. For instance, the many, many, many Chevy dealerships in southeastern PA whittled down to, I've heard numbers like only 3 or 4. As the patriarch of the association, who do you think is going to survive? What types of dealerships can survive, and why is that? Who's going to win, who's going to lose, in your perspective?
Well, that's a very difficult question for me to answer because, as I've explained, I am very new to the automotive industry. Mm-hmm. My background is event management. But from the meetings that I've attended, I can tell you in Pennsylvania, we went from 1,200 dealerships. I lost about 75 this past year.
Okay.
We're hoping that we finish 2009 still with 1,000 dealerships. Pennsylvania has had probably the largest number of dealerships in the country other than California. Part of that stems back from the original concept that the big three had when they started the dealership franchise, and that they wanted a point on every corner. They wanted to have as many locations as
accessibility,
possible.
Again,
we were not a mobile society. We weren't traveling miles and miles and miles to get to the car dealer, so they had to be accessible to us, exactly as you said. When many of the imports came along, times had changed. They didn't need all those points. So you're seeing a community like the Lehigh Valley that may have 15 GM dealerships and 2 Nissan dealerships. So it's serving the same amount of community, but there's less competition in those brands. I think many of the larger brands who have sought out to have multiple points, a point in the industry is a individual franchise.
Mm-hmm.
So you may have Mazda, VW, and Dodge together. And hopefully when one is not doing as well, the other two are really strong. Those types of franchises probably have a much better chance of going forth because their product mix is different. Individuals have a single point or a single manufacturer may be difficult depending on what the model mix of that manufacturer. Mm-hmm. If it's a lot of SUVs when gas is $4, they're not going to sell.
So diversity is important. And one of the things you're saying is certainly individual dealerships may be more at risk if they don't have the diversity. That's where some of this merger is coming about, too, these dealerships that are merging and combining.
I agree with you 100%. I think from my perspective, and again, it's a very new perspective in the automobile industry, the way the whole franchise program was started, the manufacturer tried to take as much guesswork out of the sale as possible. The independent franchiser buys everything from the dealership. So when times are good and the product line is good and the marketing materials nationwide are good, national advertising is good, cars sell. when some of those things break down and the economy slows down, individual dealers are individual business people who all have different styles of running their business. So the smarter ones, the ones who have gravitated to internet marketing. My daughter just bought a car. She didn't go into a showroom. She did all her research on the internet.
Yeah.
So dealers who can adapt and look in different ways and modify their way of doing business, I think have a better chance of surviving.
And you're talking surviving with that and being creative with their surviving. You just came back from the National Auto Dealers Association conference in Washington, D.C. And just curious with that, there has to be a lot of discussion going on. How's the industry going to survive? What do you see that needs to change for the industry to survive and how that's going to impact us in the Valley?
Well, it was the National Auto Dealers Association was in New Orleans. So when we weren't on Bourbon Street, we were talking about a lot of things. I think there was as much uncertainty in those meetings as there is on the street in hometown Pennsylvania. Yeah. Many of the dealers are looking for the manufacturers to give us clear-cut answers on what's going to happen. And quite frankly, I don't think the manufacturers, to a large degree, understand that. If you talk to GM dealers, they will tell you, we know Chevy's going to be here, we know Cadillac's going to be here, probably GM and Pontiac, certainly Buick on a worldwide basis, but what about the other two? Will there be a Saturn? Will there be a Hummer? No one really knows that, and until the manufacturer clears those things up, the dealers are all living from a day-to-day basis.
Sure. And as you corrected me, the association was in New Orleans, but we also had some attention down in Washington
because
there's been that show going on there and all the emphasis being placed on what's happening with Washington and what's going to happen with the bailout.
What about the bailout? What does the association see as that impact? Will it matter? Is it helping?
That's a very difficult question for me to answer. Now, hopefully some of the my member dealers who are coming in later can help you more with that. I think from the bailout perspective, the dealers I've talked to said it's not a matter of buyers being around. The market is still there. Mm-hmm. It's who can get financing. Certain manufacturers are no longer leasing. When you've programmed people to lease vehicles for a long period of time, and then you said we've stopped our leasing program, the volume or the price of the car they can get has dropped way down. So it confuses people. And some of the financial institutions, I think, have made it very difficult or confusing as to what is out there. There certainly is money available out there. There certainly are people who are buying cars. It's a matter for the environment to really take more shape. And I wish I had a clear-cut answer for you, but
nobody does.
The magic dust over the car industry.
Okay.
Tom Kwadek is here. And can you give us, in just our last 30 seconds, where do you see the auto industry in the next 6 to 12 months?
Well, I wanted to make point that the auto dealers, particularly the Lehigh Valley auto dealers, contribute $450 million in sales revenue each year, sales of new cars, to the state of Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania depends about 22% of its total sales sales tax revenue is on new car sales. There's always going to be a market. People always want their cars. We think by the time the industry is saying, by the time 2010 rolls along, industry, the pent-up demand is going to be there. The new cars are going to be off the production lines. There's going to be a year and a half under the new administration. We think that 2010 is going to be a huge
there's a light there.
Okay, we'll see. Let's hope for it. Thank you, Tom Kwiatek from the Greater Lehigh Valley Auto Dealers Association. Thanks so much for joining us, Tom.
Thank you.
And that's his insight. We'd love to get yours from all our viewers. Sure. We need your opinions.
And please drop us an email, whether it be about our show or topics for future shows. Send it to us at publicsquare@wlvt.org.
Up next, right here on Tempo Public Square, we'll meet Brian Hathaway, a man on the money side of the auto biz who has faced a layoff. Welcome back to Tempo Public Square. As we know, when the economy turns, it impacts people as well as companies and communities.
Brian Hathaway is a financial services manager caught up in the shortfall. He's here to share his story with us now.
I'm Brian Hathaway, and this is my story. I've been in the automobile business since 1982. I'm currently 46 years old. I started the first 2 years as a salesperson, then I became a finance manager, sales manager, general sales manager, eventually a general manager. But the bulk of my time has been spent as a finance manager. For the last 15 years, I've worked for five dealerships at the same location in Jenkintown. And unfortunately, 2 weeks before Christmas, the entire sales department was shut down, and I, along with a number of other individuals, lost my job. On New Year's Eve, the rest of the dealership was shut down, the service side of things. And the sad thing for me, the thing that was very, very troubling, along with watching good people lose their jobs, is that because our business shut down, the opportunity to continue health insurance under COBRA also went away. I think that more than any other thing has stayed with me. But as I said, I started in the business in 1982, and just to give you a perspective on it, by the end of 1982, interest rates were at 18% on new cars. That was one of the worst years, and we're certainly back in a valley again. I can remember some of the mountains, though, when we were at 0% and everything was fine. I'm optimistic that that's going to happen again, and I'm optimistic that, once again, this country will get back to where it was. The thing that people forget is that one out of five Americans is either directly or indirectly somehow involved in the automobile industry. And we have really paid a terrible price with what has happened economically in the last year or so in this country. And people need to always remember that it's not just about the sale of the car, it's also the financing, it's also the insurance, it's also the manufacturing side, it's also the credit, the collection side of it that everybody's affected by. But I am optimistic that things will get better. I'm Brian Hathaway, and that's my story.
Thank you, Brian. You know, it's not easy to deal with these issues, but fortunately for Brian, he was able to find another job. So,
and that's good news for him, absolutely. Yeah. To help us put all this together, we have some dealers in our audience today. Actually, on our set right now, we have Andy Dobb, the senior partner from Brown Dobb Dealerships. Thanks so much for being here, Andy. And Andy Scott, the president of the Scott family of dealerships. Both of you gentlemen, thanks so much for being here today.
Great to be here.
We're glad to have you here. First question out to both of you, but we'll start with you, Andy Dobb. How has your dealership been impacted by what's gone on with the economy?
Well, our sales are off substantially. We're primarily a domestic dealer. We handle the Detroit Big Three, and of course, it's not news to anybody that their sales are way off, and we've reflected that as well. So I guess I'd have to say that we've had a significant decline.
In new car sales, how's that been relating to service issues, used car sales, layoffs, or?
Used car sales have held up pretty well. Mm-hmm. Service is off a little bit, mm-hmm. unlike normally, and I've been around a long time, so I've been through these, you know, it's always been a cyclical business.
Right.
But it used to be that people would fix up their cars if they didn't buy a new car.
Yes.
What I'm finding now is that people are holding off. They're not spending money on fixing up their car, and they're not spending money on replacing their car. So I think when people get a better sense of what's going to happen, I think they're going to move one way or the other.
So they're not spending money either way. Yeah.
That's right. My experience. Mm-hmm. I don't know about you.
What do you say?
I would say the same thing.
You
know, we're seeing some new car buyers shift to used cars, and we are also seeing some people putting off maintenance issues with their cars, which is going to impact them eventually. They're either going to have to buy or service at that point.
Do you see, you read a lot about that their greatest fear is that if they were to buy a new car, that they're worried that you won't be around to offer the warranty or the auto manufacturer.
Yeah, I think that's sort of a false fear.
Okay.
I mean, certainly the government, the manufacturer is going to step in and warranties will be honored. So I don't think that's an issue as it relates to, you know, anything that would have an immediate impact on our business.
So declining sales, declining service visits, what about the relationship between you guys and your relationship with your providers, your oil department,
the whole chain.
The whole chain. I mean, it's a fingery thing.
Part suppliers.
Part suppliers, inspection agencies, all those relationships.
No question that there's somewhat of a strain right now. We're doing the best to maintain a good relationship with them. And we're all team players. We'll do our part to try to help them succeed as well as we want them to do their part to help us succeed. But it's a tough situation right now. Certainly we have had some layoffs, not a significant amount. We're trying to hold where we are now, but certainly we've been impacted negatively with the latest economic issues.
Mm-hmm. The value chain for you, Andy, it's, you know, when you talk about not having service, you're not buying parts, that's affecting part suppliers.
Well, yeah, it does. Service is not down significantly. The difference is that in a downturn like this in new car sales, we usually see an uptick in service, and I'm not seeing that uptick in service. So really, I wouldn't say that our purchases of parts and supplies has been negatively impacted. It's just that we don't have the positives that we used to get when people stopped buying new cars. Our biggest problem is new car sales. That's the one department in our dealerships that has seen a substantial decline.
Well, let's flip the page to something that's really been in the paper a lot, and that's the bailout and what's coming out of Washington. There's already, especially as you've talked, Andy, you're primarily domestic, but there's already been money given. Has that found its way into assisting you? And if not, why not? And then, you know, what about the things that are going on now? Is there going back by the end of March to try to get more money?
I think that bailout is the term, I guess, people use, but it's really loan guarantees. Right. And I was a Chrysler dealer back when Lee Iacocca coaxed the government to do a similar thing for Chrysler back, I don't know, 20 years ago or whatever it was. The government got repaid, handsomely repaid, and made out very well. And I think that's going to happen this time as well. I think the fact that the government is guaranteeing the loans and the companies can get the money, they're not. It's not free money either. It's expensive money for them, but they don't have any alternative, so they've got to take the government money. But that's having a very positive impact because people have faith in the product again, and faith. They recognize that the General Motors and Chrysler and Ford are going to be around, and so I think they have a lot more comfort in purchasing because they don't have to worry about the warranty and that kind of thing.
Is this the best way to handle it, do you think, Andy Scott, through this loan program?
Well, I think it was necessary. Mm-hmm. And we'll see how it turns out. Certainly there's going to be consolidation in our industry, both right. from a manufacturer standpoint and a dealer standpoint. GM has announced that they want to reduce their number of dealers from about 6,500 down to maybe 4,700 dealers. Right. So it's going to have an impact long term. I think the strong will survive, and those of us that are a little bit diversified, you know, hopefully we'll be able to make it through. But it's going to be tough. There's no question about that.
Yeah. Do you have any comment on that, Andy?
No, I think that this is going to go on for a while. I don't know how long. I see 2009 being a difficult year, but we have cut back. We have had to lay off people. We don't advertise as much as we used to advertise. We're just more conservative in what we spend, but we wait, we work it through, and business is going to come back. And I think when it comes back, we're going to be stronger than ever.
Where do you see yourselves and your dealerships 6-12 months from now as compared to others in the Valley?
Well, I think we're looking to stabilize, which I think we've done. We've all made the adjustments necessary that we've needed to make since September, October, and hopefully we're in a stable position. Able to sell fewer cars and still break even is really the goal right now. Really, break even.
Tremendous
overhead.
You own all the cars and the lots outright or through loans. I mean, how do you do this financially?
We didn't even get into the floor planning.
Yeah, right. That's true.
Fortunately, money is very cheap right now, so that's not a major expense.
Okay.
Unlike in, 79, 80, when interest rates were up around 20-22%, it was killing us, and people weren't buying cars, and it was costing us a fortune to inventory.
But there's still a lot out there.
We
have run out of time. Right. There's so many more questions, but we appreciate you being here
Good
today.
Good to be here. Thank
Andy Scott and Andy Dobb, dealers from the Lehigh Valley area and beyond, thanks so much for being
here.
Thanks.
Sure.
All right.
Okay.
Coming up next, Pam Varcone has some final thoughts.
Most everyone remembers their first love, that feeling of exhilaration like you could fly. The yearning for the next encounter, imagining where the future would take the two of you, the longing to be able to touch the steering wheel of your first car. The roar of a V8 engine gave many of us the first feeling of power we had ever known. America's love affair with its cars is as old as the auto industry, and like many long-term relationships, the bloom is off the rose. Uncertainty about gas prices, combined with a tightened credit market and a faltering economy, has left consumers leery of spending money, if they can get a loan at all, on a product built by a company that may not be able to provide service or back up their warranty. Caught in the middle are the auto dealers, many of whom are second and third generation family dealerships, people who have spent decades building goodwill and a good reputation in their communities. Rather than carry high-priced new car inventory, several Lehigh Valley dealerships have converted to selling only used cars. During a recent lecture at Lehigh University's Business School, focusing on the current economic crisis, College of Business and Economics Associate Dean Martin Saffer, who worked for Ford Motor Corporation for 30 years, said he fears the big three automakers are headed down the same road as our own Bethlehem Steel. Despite the gloomy outlook, the Greater Lehigh Valley Auto Dealers Association, whose members employ 2,500 people and pump over $1 million of salary and benefits into the economy, is moving full steam ahead with plans for its March 2009 auto show titled Green is the Color of the Year. The show plans to feature cars that offer gas savings, along with several new hybrid models and hydrogen concept cars. If going green doesn't appeal to you, also on display will be the new Mustang Bullet car. Be still my heart, I'm in love again.
Thanks, Pam. As a reminder, you can watch this and any of our previous shows online by going to WLVT.org, click on Tempo, then click on Tempo Public Square. Then choose the show by air date or topic.
And next week, we talk with State Senator Rob Wunderling. He's also the head of the State Senate Transportation Committee.
We'll tackle transportation challenges next time on Tempo Public Square.
Support for Tempo Public Square is provided by the members of PBS 39 and by
building a workforce system called PA CareerLink Lehigh Valley. Training the workforce to meet employer hiring needs. Connecting employers with workers and workers with jobs. Lehigh Valley Workforce Investment Board.